Simon & Schuster Audio presents Smokescreen by Sandra Brown. Read by Victor Slezak.
Prologue. Thank God he was still asleep. Waking up to find herself in bed with Jay Burgess was embarrassing enough without having to look him in the eye, at least not until she had time to collect herself. As carefully as possible, she inched to the side of the bed and slipped out from under the sheet, trying not to lift it away from him in the process. She perched on the very edge of the mattress and glanced over her shoulder. The draft from the air conditioning vent above the bed was cold, causing goosebumps to break out on her arms. But although Jay was naked and covered only to his waist, the chilly air hadn't roused him. Shifting her weight from the bed to her feet a little at a time, she stood up. The room tilted. To keep from falling, she instinctually reached out for support. Her hand found the wall with a smack that might just as well have been a cymbal crash for the reverberation it created in the silent house. No longer concerned so much about waking him as about wondering how in the world she got so terribly drunk last night, she remained propped against the wall, taking deep breaths, focusing on one spot until her equilibrium returned. Miraculously, her clumsiness hadn't wakened Jay. Spying her underpants, she crept to the foot of the bed and retrieved them, then tiptoed around the room, gathering strewn articles of her clothing, hugging each garment against her chest in a gesture of modesty, which under the circumstances was rather ridiculous. The walk of shame. The college phrase seemed apropos. It referred to a co-ed who sneaked out of a guy's bedroom after spending the night with him. She was way past college age, and both she and Jay were single, free to sleep together if they chose. If they chose. The phrase struck her like the cruel pop of a snapped rubber band. Suddenly, the shock of waking up in Jay's bed was replaced by the alarming realization that she didn't remember how she'd got there. She didn't recall making a conscious decision to sleep with him. She didn't remember weighing the pros and cons and deciding in favor of it. She didn't remember being wooed until practicality was obscured by sensuality. She didn't remember giving a mental shrug and thinking, "What the hell, we're adults." She didn't remember anything. Looking around, she took in the layout and furnishings of the bedroom. It was a pleasant room, tastefully decorated and tailored for a man who lived alone. But nothing in it was familiar to her. Nothing. It was as though she was seeing it for the first time. Obviously, it was Jay's place. There were pictures of him scattered about, mostly vacation snapshots with various friends of both sexes. But she had never been in this room before, nor in this house. She wasn't even certain of the street address, although she had a vague recollection of walking here from somewhere. Yes, the wheelhouse. She and Jay had met there for a drink. He'd already had several when she arrived, but that wasn't uncommon. Jay liked spirits and had an amazing tolerance for large quantities of alcohol. She had ordered a glass of white wine. They'd sat and chatted over their drinks, catching up on what was happening in each other's life. Then he'd said, remembering now what he told her, she shivered, but not from the cold. She'd been staggered by it. Had compassion moved her to affection? Did that explain the lovemaking that had followed? Lord, why couldn't she remember? She went into the living room, where she found her crumpled clothes and an open, almost empty bottle of scotch. Quickly, she went back through the bedroom, finding the bathroom on the far side of it. She managed to close the door without making a sound, a precaution that was canceled out a moment later when she retched noisily into the toilet. Stepping into the shower, she washed carefully and thoroughly between her legs and shampooed her hair. Once out of the shower, she didn't tarry. Surely all the noise she'd made had woken him up by now. She dressed, used his hairbrush to smooth out her wet hair, then bolstered her courage with a deep breath and opened the bathroom door. Jay was still asleep. How could that be? He was a well-conditioned drinker. But apparently, Last night had been an overindulgence even for him. Years ago, they'd had a brief affair that soon flamed out, ending long before it developed into a bona fide relationship. But Jay, charming and irrepressible Jay, hadn't stopped trying to lure her back into his bed whenever their paths crossed. She would have expected him to be up early this morning to gloat over his conquest, waking her up with a kiss and teasing invitation to have breakfast in bed. She could almost hear him saying, "Since you're here, you might just as well relax and enjoy the full Burgess treatment." Or why hadn't he joined her in the shower? That would be a Jay kind of thing to do. But the shower hadn't disturbed him, not even the repeated flushing of the toilet. How could he sleep through all that? He hadn't even moved. Her stomach gave a heaving motion like an ocean swell. "Jay?" she said tentatively. Then louder. "Jay?" Nothing. No sigh or snuffle. Not even a slight shift of position. She stood rooted to the floor, her heart thumping hard now. Forcing herself to move, she lurched toward the bed, hand outstretched to touch his shoulder and give it a firm shake. "Jay." Chapter 1. Raley pulled open the rusty screen door, its hinges squealing.
"Hey, you in here?"
"Ain't I usually?"
A curl of faded red paint flaked off when the wood frame slapped closed behind Raley as he stepped into the one-room cabin. It smelled of fried pork and the mouse-gnawed army blanket on the cot in the corner. It took a moment for his eyes to adjust to the dimness and find the old man. He was sitting at a three-legged table, hunched over a cup of coffee like a dog guarding a hard-won bone, staring into the snowy screen of a black-and-white television. Ghostly images flickered in and out. There was no audio except for a static hiss. "Good morning." The old man snorted a welcome through his sheaves of nasal hair.
"Help yourself."
He nodded toward the enamel coffee pot on the stove.
"Can't recommend the cream. It curdled overnight."
The coffee probably had been boiled several times and would be the consistency of molasses. Without cream to dilute it, Raley thought it better to pass. He glanced at the silent TV.
"You need to adjust your rabbit ears."
"Ain't the rabbit ears. I'll turn off the sound."
"How come?" The old man replied with one of his customary harumphs that said he couldn't be bothered to answer. A self-proclaimed recluse, he had lived in voluntary exile ever since the war, although which war had never been specified. He had as little as possible to do with other Homo sapiens. Shortly after Raley had moved into the vicinity, he'd come upon the old man setting traps in the woods. Once Delna realized that Raley had no interest in the possums and other varmints he caught, the two had developed a quasi-friendship founded on loneliness and a shared reluctance for interaction with other people. Surprisingly, he was very well-read and conversant on subjects which, to look at him, one wouldn't have expected him to even have a passing knowledge of. Raley came to suspect that his hillbilly accent and vocabulary were affected. Like the squalor he lived in, they were protests against a former life. But whatever that former life had entailed remained Delno's secret. Raley shared nothing personal with Delno either, not for the first 2 years of their acquaintanceship. And then one evening at sunset, Delno showed up at Raley's cabin, bringing with him two mason jars filled with a murky liquid that he'd fermented himself.
"Hain't seen ye over a week. Where ye been?"
"Here." Raley didn't want company, but Delno elbowed his way inside anyway.
"Thought you might be needing a swig or two."
Somehow Delno managed to break through the younger man's reserve and sat next to him through the night. It was dawn before Raley stopped talking. By then, Delno had drained both jars. Raley was simply drained, emotionally, mentally, physically. It had been a painful but therapeutic catharsis. He had lanced a dozen wounds. With nothing more to say, and no breath left to say it, Raley looked over at the old man, who had listened for hours without making a single comment. The expression on the creased, leathery face was one of profound sadness. It seemed Delno Pickens.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.